Okay, I think this is working. How's everybody doing?
Good.
Good.
How are you, Steve?
I'm doing great. I don't have to talk next week. So, O'Neill and is our first speaker next Monday, followed by Dr. Lynn. So that'll be good.
And that's the first day of speaking.
Yes, it's next Monday. Next Monday, April 3rd. Beautiful. And so I just wanted to, before we begin, if you read the syllabus, and I did just to make sure I hadn't forgotten anything, one of the things it says is that give feedback to the presenters. So when you come in next week, I don't know if you can see that, you'll see a white sheet of paper, but perhaps if I get the light off of here, Wow. Special effects. No expense spared. So, in case you can't read that, because I don't think you really can't read that very well. I don't want to zoom in because I had a bad experience zooming in on the first day of class. It basically, when I'm asking people for feedback, it's you say who the speaker is, so I make sure it goes to the right person, so I don't confuse the two speakers. Give at least one thing the presenter did well. Everybody does something well. Give at least one thing the presenter can improve on. Everybody has something to improve on. Now, I discourage you from pulling a Gennaro Berichese type move. So I did this for graph theory, and most of the class here did not take graph theory. Dr. Lynn was in there, and Dr. Hesse was in there. Is that the extent of it? Was anybody else in my graph theory class? It was a long time ago. So, but anyways, I taught it, and she gave presentations, all the students gave presentations, but she could never give any feedback that said, well, there's something you need to work on. So she only ever gave the positive feedback, except in one case. Can you guess who it was that she gave some? Yes, it was me. The only time she said, well, I think you could have gone slower. The only time she had any criticism was for me. So that's a gutsy move. But, you know, she got a PhD, so sometimes it works. So anyways, this is not meant to be very profound. This is just sort of a, you know, it's good to practice giving talks, because you will give many talks in your life if you become a professional mathematician, and I hope you will. Most of you are graduate students in mathematics. Some of you who are not yet graduate students in mathematics will become that one day. And it's good to be able to practice speaking. A lot of people have the belief that speaking comes naturally. You are either a good speaker or you are not a good speaker. That is not true. Speaking is a skill which, like any other skill, you develop. If you go and you see conferences and you're like, wow, that person gave a really amazing talk, you can bet that was not the first time they gave that talk. They have probably given that talk 50 times. And they are practiced. They have it down, rehearsed. It's choreographed. So you can get better. You can get better. And the other thing is, look, there are different styles of giving talks. If you go to various conferences, you'll see different people present in different ways. There's the Doron Zalberger approach, which I don't know if anybody's ever seen Doron Zalberger give a talk, except I have. And I'll tell you that if you were able to make a transcript of his talks, every sentence would have at least two, if not three or four, exclamation marks at the end. Just ah, da da da, and then of course he has to make these preposterous claims. Aha! There really are only finitely many numbers. There's a biggest number. It's just so big we haven't seen it yet. Ah, you know. But he's very entertaining to watch, and he's a good mathematician. A little crazy, but a good mathematician. Of course, I'm not encouraging you to go that route. There are also people who are very well honed. So I work a lot with Ron Graham, and almost always, if you ever talk to me, I always start my stories with, Ron once told me, dot dot dot. That's like in fact, almost all my stories begin that way. Ron once told me. But I've also talked to a lot of people. And one of the things that amazes me is that people remember his talks. Like, if you ask me about a talk I saw 5 years ago, I probably have, at best, a vague recollection, if that. But what they remember is not the content of the talk. They remember him because of how well he gave the talk. And he would invest time and do all sorts of fun gags. So one of the funnest that I heard about was, and you're too young to know about this, but they used to have overhead projectors. I'm not talking about like this, where there was a bright light here and it would project onto the screen. And you had to be careful not to stand right in front of it, or you'd blind yourself. Of course, some mathematicians, Erdős was, for instance, didn't know how to work with that, and so he stood staring at the overhead projector with it going right into his eyes for an hour. But you know, that's because he's Erdős. He can do that. But anyway, so he's giving a talk, and there were two overhead projectors set on two sides of the room, and he would walk back and forth between them and put a new slide up and point to various things, and he'd go to the other one, put the new slide up on that side, point to various things. And so at one point in the talk, he was pointing to something, and then he walked to the other side of the room and started pointing to something else. And he said, "Okay, now remember what I was pointing to on the other side." And then you looked, there was still a finger pointing there. What he had done is he'd brought in a fake hand and had been using that to point and had left a fake hand as he moved across. And when people started realizing it, they got quite a kick out of it, you know. And so there's things like that. I don't encourage you to become a stand-up comedian. I will say, if you're familiar with Eric Demain, he's a youngest faculty member ever at MIT. That almost always happens that when you talk about the youngest faculty members, it's always in math. At UCLA, youngest faculty member was? Terry Tao! Yeah, of course. Was that? I didn't know he was that obscure. No, I didn't know he was that obscure. Okay. How about Harvard? Youngest faculty member at Harvard? Well, he was a mathematician. Okay. No Melkies. But, you know, and it happens time after time after time. So, but anyways, that wasn't the point. Eric Demain, he took actually improv classes, so that he could get better at giving lectures. And so he does all sorts of really weird, strange things, like faking a phone call in the middle of a class and things. Richard Beraldi, whose name you may have heard, and some of you may have met, actually. He's a very nice gentleman. He's retired now. He was at University of Wisconsin-Madison. He does karaoke. And you know, he loves to go out. And it's just sort of a way to help break out of your mold. You know, the point here is, I got way sidetracked from what I was trying to say a few minutes ago. You can get better at giving talks. And maybe karaoke can help. I don't know. All right. So this is essentially more or less my last day. So I thought I was going to do this last time, but then I discovered I'm going really slowly. So I'm going to do it today. So that's all right. So I want to talk about the Shannon capacity. So this is something that you probably know, and if you've seen this before, I can pretty much tell you it's the same proof because there's only one proof. So Shannon capacity. I was thinking I'd like draw a picture of Shannon because this is a person. His name is Claude Shannon, but unfortunately my skills are such that my picture would be something along the lines of the following: Claude Shannon. But anyways, he was a mathematician who worked at Bell Labs and is oftentimes considered the father of information technology. Now, I know he was a very good mathematician because he also did the mathematics of juggling. So there's something called Shannon's juggling formula. So all good mathematicians juggle. And so if you need practicing to become a good mathematician, just let me know. I have a lot of extra juggling balls in my office. I'm happy to loan it to you to help you develop as a mathematician. So anyways, the Shannon capacity asks a very simple question. Let's suppose we want to send data, and what's the sort of the best that we can send data through a channel? Now, to sort of build this up, we're going to focus on one case in particular. There might be one of, we're familiar with binaries, 0 and 1, but let's suppose there's a system where I can actually send one of 5 symbols through. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So I can send anything of 1 through 5 through my channel. But there's a problem. It turns out that some things I can very easily distinguish. So maybe 1 and 3, I can easily tell that they're not the same. But sometimes other things are hard to distinguish. Maybe 1 and 2 are hard to distinguish. So I want to be careful here, because I think there could be confusion. So I want to guarantee that there's no confusion. Let's suppose for a second we have the following, that let's put an edge between anything which might be confused. So if I try to send 1 or 2, I can't decide whether 1 should be 2 or vice versa. 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 1. So in other words, it's the 5 cycle, C5. And I say, well, look, I just have to be careful. I just want to make sure that whatever I send through, clearly there's no confusion. There's no chance that people will misinterpret what I've sent. Now, you might think this is somewhat silly. There's a nice book. So the mostly of what I'm going to follow today comes from Yuri Matusek's book, 33 Miniatures. It's a really nice presentation on this. And he said, well, maybe what you're doing is you're sending like secret coded messages by using colored scarves. And depending on what color of scarf you're wearing, people will interpret something. But your compatriot has bad eyesight. So sometimes they can't distinguish between a purple scarf and a red scarf. But a purple scarf and a green scarf, they can definitely tell those apart. So, you know, it's just sort of a things are close, might be hard to distinguish. Things are far in the color spectrum, they're easy to distinguish. Well, if I was just going to send a message, well, the best I can do if I just send, let's say, one piece of information, or if you like, with the scarf, you know, after one day, the best I can do is to say, well, I'll pick 2 things which can't be confused. So what's an example of 2 things which can't be confused? 2 and 4. Okay. So I can send either 2 or 4. And I can do this on every day. So one day I send 2, one day I send 4, maybe the next day I send 4, and I keep choosing. And in this way, essentially what does that say? It says every time I send something through, I really get one of 2 pieces of information, 1 of 2. Okay, that's not so bad. But could we do better? Well, it turns out that instead of thinking about sending over one, and I hate to use the word bit, because whenever I use the word bit, people tend to think binary, 0, 1. But one piece of information. Instead of sending one piece of information, let me send 2. So I'll send things as pairs. So it's a little bit less clear, but I claim the following set of pairs are good. So 1, 1, 2, 3, 3, 5, 4, 2, 5, 4. Now, what do I mean by they're good? These 5 have the following property. Any 2 out of the 5 will not be confused. In other words, there's something which distinguishes it, either in the first or the second part. So we can try this. Pick any pair.
5, 4.
Okay, there's 5, 4. And all right, now pick another pair.
2, 3.
5, 4, and 2, 3. Now you might say, wait a second, 5, 4, and 2, 3, the 3 and the 4 are adjacent. They could be confused. But we also sent the 2. And the 2 and the 5, they're far. They can't be confused. So there's no way that the message 5, 4 and the message 2, 3 would be confused with each other. So I can distinguish between those two. I can decide between those two messages. Now, what happened? Well, if the first case, when I was talking about sending either 2 or 4, essentially the amount of information was I got 2 bits of information, 1 of 2 things. Now here, when I go to length 2, well, I'm now sending 1 of 5 messages through, but I had to send 2 things along. So how much information did I get? Well, the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to think of it as square root of 5. Why square root? Well, because I'm sending two things. So it's like to the 1/2 power, to 1 over 2 power. And where's the 5? Because I can get 5 messages through. So, okay. So in other words, by sending things as pairs, I get slightly more information through. That's good. Could I do even better? Maybe if I send things as triples or quadruples. Well, let's be careful here, and let's talk about what we're trying to do. So let's step back. So here, this number 2. You chose 2, 4. What do 2 and 4 represent? Beth, since you chose it, what do they represent in this graph? Yes, they represent non-adjacent vertices, which can also be interpreted as
different colored scarves,
which could also be interpreted as an independent set. Okay, so in particular, Beth did in her own unique way was to choose an independent set of size 2 in the graph. All right. Now 5, well, can we think about this in terms of a graph? We can. So what we can do is we can form a new graph. Well, let's think about what the new graph would be. I'd want the vertices of the new graph, and I'll sort of argue what it should be, and then we'll say, we know what it is. I'm going to take them to be pairs with 1, the first entry, a vertex from the original graph, the second entry, a vertex from the original graph. So in other words, the vertices are the Cartesian products. Okay, so that's good. We've seen these kinds of things before. And why are we doing this? Well, because what we're doing here is we're just trying to take all possible words, and to find all possible words, we just fill it in. Okay. How about the edges? Well, what do I want to make sure? I want to make sure that there can be no confusion. So I'm going to say there's an edge. I almost misspelled edge. Edge between a pair, let's say u comma v, and x comma y, if, well, what are some things we have to avoid?
We don't want to see two adjacencies.
All right. So we want to make sure, so for example, if u is adjacent to x and v is adjacent to y, that's bad. We want to make sure that we don't take both of those, because we can't use both of those in our set of messages. What else?
Same as one
adjacent to the other. Or u equals x and v is adjacent to y, or u is adjacent to x and v is equal to y. All right, so those are the edges. Now, this might seem familiar. What graph operation have we just discovered? All right, Beth has signaled using her physical aspects here about she has given me a sign, something along the lines of that. Is everybody else know how to interpret that? Do we have a name for this? It's a strong product. Yeah. So it turns out that what this is doing here is that this is finding an independent set in the strong product of C5 and C5. All right, so now we can get an idea of what we're after. So in general, we say the Shannon capacity of a graph, G, is defined as the following. It's going to be alpha, and I'll write down everything here in a second. Probably thought the audio stopped working because I became silent for a second. All right, here we go. So first off, alpha. What is alpha? Alpha is notation, which is just saying the independence number. This is the size of the largest independence set. In other words, I want to find what's the maximum number of vertices such that no pair share an edge. You might hear this sometimes called an anticlique. So I'm finding the independence number of what? Well, the graph, that's the strong product of G with G with G with G, and we're going to do this k times. And those are going to form, essentially, more or less, you can think of them as forming the basic words in my code. For instance, when we just had 1, we had 2, 4, 1 at length 2, 1, 1, 2, 3, 3, 5, 4, 2, 5, 4, and so forth and so on. And now I say, well, remember, I'm taking words of length k, and I need to compensate, so I need to take it to the 1 over kth power, because I want to say how much is going through each bit. How much can I send through one bit? So I take it to 1 over k, and now I do this for every k, at least 1, and I say, what's the largest? Okay, so that's the definition, and this is capital theta of G, the Shannon capacity. Now, I will say, in case you're wondering, you're probably thinking, okay, this sounds like a fairly easy parameter to compute. I will say that it is not a very easy parameter to compute. It's known for all graphs up through 5 vertices, and we're going to find what theta of C5 is. In fact, we have a pretty good guess. What's our guess? It's square root of 5 is a great guess. Because we said, well, look, this is k equals 2. We're taking the soup, so at least at k equals 2, we can achieve that. So that's known. It's known also that theta of C6 is 3. This should not surprise you. Because what's true about C6? What do you have in C6? You have an independent set of size 3. So in that one, it's been very boring. In fact, very boring. Theta of C7. Well, the answer is nobody knows. Not because of lack of trying. They've been trying to solve this probably for about 50 years. So as best I can tell, it's somewhere between 3.317 and 3.223, which is pretty close. We have it within 0.1, but that's not the same as knowing it. Mathematicians, they're not satisfied. They want to know it. They go get the real answer, not an approximation. All right, so anyways, our goal is to convince ourselves in the next 25 minutes that this is actually true. Theta of C5 is root 5. Okay, so you're probably wondering, what does this have to do with linear algebra? Good question. So let's talk about what's known as orthogonal representations. So in particular, orthogonal representations of graphs. If I have a graph, what I can do is I can associate each vertex with a vector. And I can choose them to be the same vector. Generally, I don't do that. Or I can choose them to be different vectors. But I can do this. I can associate each vector, each vertex gets its own vector. And I'm not putting any constraint on the dimensionality. So if my graph has 20 vertices, I can choose dimension 2. If it has 2 vertices, I can choose dimension 20. But I pick a dimension. So all the vectors have the same dimension. So somehow what I'm doing is I'm saying, well, let's somehow use information about linear algebra, in particular about vectors. Now, at this point, I've said associate vertices with vectors. This really has not yet tied into the graph, so let's define this. Such that, and I want two things. One, all vectors are unit vectors, so That's something nice. We'll use that. And two, the second thing I want to do is I really want to make sure that I'm using the fact orthogonal. Well, and here's where it comes in. If two vertices are not adjacent, then the vectors are orthogonal. So in other words, the vertices are associated with orthogonal vectors. Okay. Now, we have to be a little bit careful here, because you might misinterpret item two. Because you are tempted to say, if two vertices are not adjacent, then vectors are orthogonal means, oh, if I'm orthogonal, there's not an edge. And if there is an edge, I'm not orthogonal. I'm not making that assumption. That's not what this is saying. It's OK if you have an edge to be orthogonal. Now, you might say, well, what if I want to make that assumption? That's awesome. You should do that. But that's not what we're going to use for this case. As an example here, let's see. Suppose I wanted to construct an orthogonal representation of K13. Can I do that? And you're probably thinking, that sounds like it's hard. But in fact, I claim it's kind of trivial. Oh, yes, do you see it? No? Yes, no. You guys are making it even harder than you need to. Well, go to R4. 1 0 0 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 1. So you'll notice, are these, is this an orthogonal representation?
Yes.
Yes. Is it a good one?
Sure. It works.
It works by the definition. It works by the definition. Yes. But ideally, what we want is we want somehow orthogonal representations to be useful. And usually, smaller dimension, the more useful, because smaller dimension, we get geometry. OK, so someone has suggested that we can just use, on the outer vertices, in dimension 3, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. And in the middle, what do we put? Yeah, the answer is, we don't care. It doesn't matter. We put anything we want. As long as it's a unit vector of some sort. So we could put 1 over root 3, 1 over root 3, 1 over root 3, for instance. We could do that. Or one of many other things. So first off, the first example, while boring, shows it always exists. And the second example shows, oh, it doesn't have to be a fixed dimension. You can pick your dimension. All right. So at this stage, we've come out with, I think this might actually be what people call it, but the umbrella. The Lovaas umbrella. And Lovaas has an accent somewhere, but I apologize. I don't know where.
It's an
upwards
accent on the
plane. Is it? OK. All right. So Lovaas. Now, I've heard that usually when you see an SZ, ignore the Z. So like if you have ever seen Semeretti, who is the academic ancestor, actually I should say academic father of Ryan Martin, you might be tempted to pronounce the Z as Shemeretti or something. But no, silent Z, Semeretti. So it might help you to pronounce it better if you just say Lovaas. Don't try to make a Lovaas. No, avoid that. OK, what's the Lovaas umbrella? Well, we're going to start in dimension 3. And I haven't drawn vectors yet. And what we're going to do is imagine that initially we have 5 vectors pointing straight up. And I should pause here. You're probably wondering, Does this have anything to do with what I was talking about? Yes. I'm trying to construct a Lobos umbrella. It's trying to relate to C5. So there's five vectors pointing straight up, and I don't know why I'm being... I spent so much money on these markers, I have to use them. So, okay, so here we go. There's five. Five are pointing straight up. Now, they're unit vectors. What you want to do is you want to imagine them as coming from straight up and starting to unfold. And so they're going to unfold, and they're going to unfold such that they are equally spaced out. Now, eventually, if you unfold all the way out and you kept going from straight up down until you hit the plane, well, what you would get is you would get a nice, let me try to draw what you would get. You would see the following. You'd see a pentagon in the plane. Now, let's make a quick little argument here, a simple one. What is the interior angle between two adjacent vertices inside of a pentagon? Regular pentagon. Well, there's 360 degrees in a full circle, and I've divided it into five, which would make, well, 2 pi over 5, but I know that we teach our calculus students to always think in radians, but we're not in calculus. So what would we call that?
72 degrees.
72 degrees. 72. All right. Now, what do I want? Well, I'm going to associate these with C5, but I'm going to have it so that literally the vertices which are only 72 degrees apart when they land, go down, would be the edges, and the non-edges would be things which were two apart. Now, twice 72 would be 144. Now, here's my point. If I start with two things where when they are straight up, their angle is zero. I start opening them up, and they go down, and eventually their angle is 144. What must be true somewhere in between? The angle is 90. So we know that there has to be, there has to be some point where I have this, and the reason they call it the umbrella is you can actually think of it as you would an umbrella. This would have worked better on last time when we actually had rain. But we've only partially opened it up, but we have this umbrella sticking up, and lo and behold, it's a nice orthogonal representation. Okay, so there we go. We found our orthogonal representation by opening up our umbrella. Okay, and that's good. Now, you're probably thinking, cute, are we going to use that? Yes, we will. Because now let's do a fact. In fact, we're going to do two facts, maybe even three. Here we go. Okay. So, fact, if G is a graph, and the collection V1 up through Vn is an orthogonal representation, then what's true is that alpha of G is going to be less than or equal to the maximum of 1 over Vi Ei squared, which, by the way, there's nothing special about, E1. E1 is simply the 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 vector. There's literally nothing special about that vector other than it's a unit vector. You just pick your unit vector, that's convenient. If we went back to our picture, what we're going to have is that E1 is going to be the one pointing straight up. So in other words, it's more or less the center of your umbrella, the handle, if you will, of your umbrella, if you were going to actually use this for rain. But of course, I'd recommend first turning it over. But okay, so that's what E1 is. Again, the E1, there's nothing sacred about it. I just need a vector of length 1. Okay, good, good. How do we prove this? Well, what do? We know that these vectors are orthogonal. And they also have length 1. So actually, they're orthonormal. Okay, true fact, true fact. All right, well, what can we do? Well, add in vectors to form a basis, and particularly an orthonormal basis. So that means, in other words, I'm going to take my v1 to vn, and then I'm going to add vn plus 1 up to v sub t, where here, what is t? T is the dimension of your vectors. Yeah, I might not even need to add anything. I might already have an orthonormal basis. But if I don't, I put some more in.
A basis or a spanning set? I don't see why V1 through Vn necessarily are linearly independent.
Because they're orthonormal. They're orthogonal. They're orthogonal vertices. They're orthogonal vectors.
But they're not pairwise orthogonal. They're just...
They're pairwise orthogonal. So if they're pairwise orthogonal, they have to be linearly independent. Well, okay, all right, you're right, you're right. Let me not do that one. I got a little bit ahead of myself. Let me back up a step. So given an orthonormal vectors, let's say U1 up to UM, then add to form orthonormal basis. So U1 to UM, comma UM plus 1 up to UT. Okay, there we go. So I'm going to come back to B's in just a moment. All right, I can do this. If I have a set of orthonormal vectors, I just keep adding until I get my space. Yes? So far, so good? Okay. All right. Okay. Well, now I'm going to make an observation. The sum I equals 1 to t of the ui e1 squared is equal to the norm of e1 squared, which is 1. Okay. Now, why is this true? Well, it's true because E1 is written as the sum I equals 1 to T of U sub I E1 times UI. So in other words, this, I can use the inner product to create my vectors. In other words, these inner products compute the coefficients of the UI, and now take E1 inner product E1, and that gives you the magnitude of E1 squared, which is 1. And if you take on the right-hand side, because these vectors are orthogonal and length 1, it will become that sum on the right-hand side. Okay, well, this is true. Now, we make an observation. This is certainly bigger than or equal to the summation I equals 1 to M of U I E1.
Squared.
Thank you. And why is that? I'm not looking for profound things. I'm looking for simple things.
You have more things in the one sum, and they're all positive.
Exactly. Thank you. I have more things in the one sum, and they're all positive. Good. That's what I was looking for. All right. So, here we go. Now, we're almost there. This quantity here is bigger than or equal to m times the min of ui e1. No? Do you want me to? Other than I probably should have a square.
Times
That's right. Take the smallest thing m times. It has to be less than or equal to that. And therefore, we can conclude that m is certainly less than or equal to, well, 1 over the smallest really means I'm trying to maximize 1 over ui e1 squared. That's absolutely true. Now, this is for any collection of orthonormal vectors. Now, all I have to do is connect this to alpha g. Well, here's the connection. I have an orthogonal representation, so I can pick alpha of g vectors from v1 up to vn, which are orthonormal. So in other words, this alpha g, I've just picked m vectors. That's how we should think of that. And so using those vectors, we can conclude alpha g is less than or equal to the max of 1 over, and here it's among the subset. Okay, so here the subset, I'll put this in parentheses, 1 over vi e1. But what can I do? So this is a subset for the vectors that were coming from an independent set. Well, say, look, I'll just ignore that I want that particular subset. I'll just take it over a max over a larger set. A max over a larger set can only make me go up. Okay. So far, so good. This is the hard part. All right. So the next thing is we say, all right, well, now I can bound things. In particular, I can go back to my umbrella here, and I have this nice umbrella. Well, not well drawn, but I have the pit. The idea of the umbrella is nice. And here's what you can do with some work, which is secret code for I'm not going to do it. You can show that in this case that alpha of C5 is going to be less than or equal to the, again, we're going to look at the max of 1 over vi e1 squared. And if you go through and carry that out, you will find out that alpha C5 is less than or equal to square root of 5. Now, you're probably not that impressed, because what have we just proven? We've just proven that 2 is less than or equal to square root of 5. Check, because the independence number of C5 is 2. All right, that's kind of disappointing. But there's one other nice fact. So here's our nice fact. If, let's suppose, I have a graph G, and it has an orthogonal representation. Let's suppose it's V1 up to Vn. And I have a graph H, and it has an orthogonal representation. Let's suppose W1 up to W sub m. Then it turns out that G strong product H also has an orthogonal representation. And that's not very hard, because every graph has an orthogonal representation. But it has a very convenient one. What would it be? Yeah, it's VI tensor WJ in all possible ways. So what can we do? Well, the point here is that we can take our orthogonal representations and build them up. Now, recall for a moment here that we just show the following. Alpha of G is less than or equal to the max of 1 over VI E1 quantity squared. Now this quantity is known as the theta function, or really I should say this is the Lovaas theta function. So it's the maximum possible representation I have. All right. Well, from this we get the following. The fact that we can build this up tells us that if I want to do the Lovaas theta function of G strong product H, it's Lovaas theta function of G times Lovaas theta function of H. So, putting this all together, we can conclude the following, and here's the punchline. I'm trying to figure out alpha of C5, where I've taken the strong product of C5 with C5 with C5 many times. This is less than or equal to the Lovaas theta function of C5, strong product of C5, so forth and so on many times. Well, which is equal to Lovaas theta function of C5 raised to the kth power, which is the square root of 5 to the k. And now, what does this imply? Well, it implies that the Shannon capacity of C5 is less than or equal to, because the independence number, I want to compute this to the 1 over k's power, is always less than or equal to square root of 5. I can never do better. We already showed it was greater than or equal to k equals 2. And therefore, we have now established that we in fact have equality. So this is a very interesting function, by the way. It's gives a nice bound for independence number, and you can use it, since you can bound independence number, you can also use that to bound chromatic number, because independence number and chromatic number are connected together. And it gives a nice sort of connection to relating graphs with linear algebra and vectors. On a side note, since I have about a minute left, there is the notion of relating graphs to vectors, and in particular, relating graphs to vectors in a slightly stronger way, namely where you have an edge if and only if the vectors are not orthogonal. And in particular, it turns out that whenever you do that, you have a really nice relationship between such representations and positive semi-definite matrices. So if you were trying to minimize the rank or maximize the nullity of a positive semi-definite matrix associated with the graph, you're actually looking for a really good representation of the graph in terms of vectors. Now, it's not always phrased that way, but that's what you're doing. All right, so starting next week, we're going to be all over the map. Lots of themes. Should be good. You should come and listen. I strongly encourage you, because you'll learn something new. And that will be it for today. See you on Monday.